So 1.4 is trigonometric functions and their inverses. So I know we briefly talked about trigonometric functions. We have sine, cosine, tangent, cotangent, secant, cosecant, right? And somebody had their saying SOHCAHTOA. See, I don't even know SOHCAHTOA. SOHCAHTOA. Where that tells you how to keep track of the relationship, right? Sine is opposite over hypotenuse, cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse, and tangent is opposite over adjacent. Again, we talked about cotangent is 1 over tangent, right? So if we take 1 over opposite over adjacent, we get adjacent over opposite, right? And then secant is 1 over what? Cosine. And then cosecant is 1 over sine, right? So, and I drew the triangle. Here's theta. Theta is always an angle, right? And opposite, adjacent, and hypotenuse are always the lengths of the sides. Hypotenuse is always across from the 90-degree angle, right? Okay. Okay, so then next we have the unit circle and the conversion between degrees and radians. Here's degrees and radians, right? And here's the unit circle. So somebody, why do we care about the unit circle? How does the unit circle help us? Okay, so here we can see on our unit circle, I have on the inside, I have the degrees. Then on the outside, I have the radians. So again, those are the measures of the angles, right? Those are measures of angles. Degrees and radians are the measures of the angles. And here I have different points on my unit circle. Unit means length 1, right? So the radius of this circle is radius 1. And then I have different points. Do you see how the points, because the radius is 1, these points are mirrors of each other, right? In the first quadrant, I have positive x, positive y. The second quadrant, I take all of those points and I have negative x, positive y. I'm just taking these and changing the sign depending on the quadrant I'm in, right? Do you see that? Mm-hmm. So if I memorize the points in one quadrant, I know them in all the quadrants without having to memorize anything new. Just know first quadrant is positive, positive. Second quadrant is negative, positive. Third quadrant, negative, negative. Fourth quadrant, positive x, negative y, right? So as long as you know them in the first quadrant, you're good, right? Then I have pi over 6, pi over 4, pi over 3, pi over 2. You know a larger denominator. A larger denominator means a smaller fraction, right? So 6, 4, 3, 2, right? Larger denominator means a bigger fraction. Okay. Why is this being brought up in the trig section? Well, what is it? You need the unit circle for trig. And you need trig for calculus. Right. And a lot of you guys are math majors, so obviously some of that. So the thing that's important is, who knows what sine of 0 is? Sine of 0 is 1? Okay, if you don't know, look at your calculator. What's sine of 0? So look, this is 0 degrees, this is 0 radians. In higher level math, we don't do degrees. We do radians, right? Okay, so sine of 0 is 0, right? So sine is your y value, and cosine is your x value. So if I ask you, what's cosine of 0? That's 1, right? What's cosine of pi over 4? I go to the angle pi over 4, and it's square root of 2 over 2. What's sine of pi over 2? I go to pi over 2, and I look at the y value. It's 1, okay? So that's why the unit circle is so helpful, because sine is the y value, cosine is the x value. If you know this, then you know all the trig functions. And again, if you look here and you memorize this, you know all of these points, and then you go to these angles, 90 degrees is pi over 2, so here if I add pi over 2 to pi over 6, I get 2 pi over 3, so I can figure out all of the angles as well. I think I said that a little bit fast. If you know the first quadrant, you know the rest. If you wanted to figure out the third quadrant from here, 180 degrees is pi, so add pi to all of these and you'll get all of these. Okay? Good. If you know all the point values in the first quadrant, you just change the signs according to the quadrant you're in. Sine is the y value, cosine is the x value. Okay? Are you guys good with that? Mm-hmm. So on the first test, you guys will not be able to use your calculator. I have a dollar store calculator you can use. So you have to know this, right? Because if I ask you what's sine of pi over 6, the dollar store calculator doesn't know. It doesn't even have a sine button, right? So you got to know this. So sine of pi over 6, again, I go to my angle of pi over 6, and I go to my y value, that's 1/2. Okay? Cosine of 5 pi over 6, I go to 5 pi over 6 right here. Cosine is which, x or y? X, so it's negative square root of 3 over 2. Okay, tangent of pi over 3. Okay, how do I do that? From my unit circle. Can I write tangent in terms of sine and cosine? What is it? Good, so it's sine pi over 3 over cosine pi over 3. Once I can put any other trigonometric function in terms of sine and cosine, then I can look at my unit circle. So what's pi over 3 is right here. Sine is the y value, so I have square root of 3 over 2 over cosine of pi over 3 is 1/2. Okay, so I have square root of 3 over 2 divided by 1/2. What does that give you? Pi over 3 over cosine pi over 3. Right, whatever this angle is here that you're doing with tangent, it's the same for sine and cosine. And then I go to my unit circle, and this is what I get. And what was the answer for this? Which is what? Square root of 3. Okay, cotangent. How can I write cotangent in terms of sine and cosine?
Cosine.
Good. And if you weren't quite sure how to get that, cotangent is 1 over tangent, right? So that's 1 over sine over cosine, which is cosine over sine. So you said 1 over square root of 3. So you went to cosine of pi, right? Cosine, here's pi. Cosine, where'd you get square root of 3? Oh. It's okay. So you go, this shouldn't be tangent. This should be cosine pi over sine pi. So here's pi. I go to my angle pi right here. Cosine is the x value, so I have negative 1 over 0. Uh-oh, what does that mean? Undefined. So anything over 0 is undefined. Okay, so what about secant? Write secant in terms of sine and cosine. Also, when we're doing all these things, if you guys do use your calculator, obviously you can use your calculator to check, but it's good to figure out how to use the unit circle. obviously for the first test, but make sure your calculator is in radians and not degrees. Some of you guys, I don't know how to use your calculators, but make sure your calculator is in radians and not degrees. Okay, so secant, what's secant in terms of sine and cosine? One over cosine, good. And then I go to my unit circle, 5 pi over 3 is where? Right here? So cosine is my x value, so I have 1 over 1 half, which is 2. What? This one? 5 pi over 3. I printed these out and gave them to you. These notes.
Yeah.
Oh. Here. Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah, I see it's a little hard. Okay, so number 6, secant of pi over 4. You guys try to do it on your own on the unit circle. And obviously, we're only doing a couple examples here, right? But you should be able to do a lot of them. Okay, so I got 1 over square root of 2 over 2, which is 2 over square root of 2. Yes. So we usually don't have square roots in the denominator. So what do we do?
You multiply by square root of 2
divided by square root of 2. Okay, so I get 2 square root of 2 over 2. Yeah?
Oh,
but I could simplify it to square root of 2, right? So, I mean, these ones wouldn't be wrong, but square root of 2 is the best. Right? Okay, so that's just a review of the trig functions, right? Here's all of our trig functions. Here, let me write here that tangent is sine over cosine, right? Tangent is sine over cosine. Cotangent, you can put all of these functions in terms of sine and cosine in order to figure out how to evaluate functions on the unit circle. Yes?
Wait, so for number 6, why did you write 1 over secant?
Oh, sorry. That should be 1 over cosine. Sorry. Okay, so again, cosine is the x value, sine is the y value. And then you can evaluate anything based on that, right? Okay, the next page are graphs of the trig functions. Okay, so sine, I'm going to change mine to colors. So sine is this blue. Right? And then cosecant is on here. The reason cosecant is on here is because cosecant is 1 over sine, right? You have these vertical asymptotes wherever sine equals 0, right? Because you get undefined values because you get 1 over 0, right? So if you have the graph of sine, you can figure out the graph of cosecant, right? Here I have the value is 1 for sine, so 1 over 1 is 1. And then, right, it makes sense, yeah? Same thing with cosine and sine. Or cosine and secant. Wherever cosine equals 0, secant has a vertical asymptote. And then here I have tangent and cotangent. Okay? So just so we know graphically what our functions look like. Tangent has those vertical asymptotes at pi over 2, 3 pi over 2, 5 pi over 2, 7 pi, right? So they're undefined at those points. And then cotangent has vertical asymptotes pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi. So are you guys comfortable with these? Yeah? So, what? So these are just the graphs of the trig functions. If you don't know them, if you know the sine and cosine, right, from sine and cosine, cosecant is 1 over sine, right? Mm-hmm. If cosecant, or if sine is 0, cosecant is 1 over sine, so that would be 1 over 0, which is undefined, which is why we have a vertical asymptote there for cosecant. Same thing with secant and cosine. Okay? So these are just all of the 6 trig functions and the graphs of them and what they look like, right? Okay. The next, we have part B, which is the trigonometric identities. We have sine squared plus cosine, this should be a squared, plus cosine squared equals 1. Make sure you put a little squared on your cosine there. The other is 1 plus tangent squared equals secant squared. And then we have 1 plus cotangent squared equals cosecant squared. Personally, I only have one of these memorized. And why is that? Because you can get the rest of them. So how do you do that, Gabriel? Can you help me? So I have sine squared theta plus cosine squared theta equals 1. That's what I know. So how do I get the other ones from this? So let's divide this all by sine squared. Okay? If I divide this all by sine squared over sine squared is 1. Cosine squared over sine squared is what?
Cotangent
squared. And then 1 over sine is what? One over sine? Oh, yeah. Cosecant. And I get that one, right? Okay, let's do it again. Sine squared theta plus cosine squared theta equals 1. Okay, first I divide everything by sine squared, now divide everything by cosine squared. So tan squared, right, sine over cosine is tangent, plus 1 equals what? 1 over secant. Oh, just secant. Thank you. So you can get the other two if you know sine squared plus cosine squared is 1, right? So sometimes people ask me the best way to study for a test, and I say, like, make flashcards of the stuff in the gray box or the definitions or the facts. But if I had to go through and make flashcards, I might put all of these on the flashcards, but know that sine squared plus cosine squared is the most important one, and that you can get the other ones, right? As long as you know those trig identities from the first page. Here's also the half angle and double angle formulas. Sine 2 theta equals 2 sine theta. Cosine 2 theta is cosine squared theta minus sine squared theta. Cosine squared theta is 1 plus cosine 2 theta over 2. So these are the half angle and double angles, right? You could use these ones to get the sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1, right? I mean, if you're bored on a Saturday. And you guys are looking for fun math stuff to do. Okay. So I know that this section is a very quick review of a lot of trig stuff, right? But you guys got to refresh it, okay? Okay, and then C, inverse trig functions. So here are the inverse trig functions. So y equals sine inverse of theta. Another way to write that is arcsine, where y is in, right, this little e, y is an element of. Y is in the set. Pi over 2 to negative pi over 2. Oh, sorry. That should be negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. Oh, all of those. All of these pi over 2 to pi over 2, they should be negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2, so these three. So y is in the set, or y is an element of the set. So we can say y is in the set, or y is an element of. Okay, so that's what that little e means. So basically, if I looked at the graph of sine, I'm restricting the domain for sine to be negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2, and that's how I'm getting the inverse sine. So this is not, so this arc sine or inverse sine is not 1 over sine. It's the functional inverse, okay? It's like the worst notation in math. The negative 1 power is not 1 over, right? If we ever have a negative exponent, we can bring it down to the denominator and make it positive. That's not this. This is inverse sine. It's the functional inverse, not the multiplicative inverse. Another way to write arc sine, to write sine inverse is arc sine. So I restrict the domain of sine to be negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. And that's how I get, remember last class we said the domain, oh, did we do that in this class? We did inverses briefly, yes? Okay, so the domain of your of sine becomes the range of sine inverse. Okay? So we have to restrict the domain of sine because if we take this sine function and we flip it over the line xy, that would be a squiggle on the y-axis, and that would not be a function, right? Let me just try. Okay, so sine, what's sine of 0? Sine of 0, 0, right? Look at the graph, right? Sine of 0, 0, and then it looks like this, right? Just keeps going, right? We could talk about the period of pi, how if you take this, it just repeats over and over, right? But we're going to restrict sine, because see, if we reflected this over across the line x equals y, which is how we graphically looked at inverses, it would look like, right? That's how it would look, and this would not be a function, right? It doesn't, the red does not pass the vertical line test of function, so this would not be a function. So that's why we're going to restrict the domain of sine in order to figure out sine inverse, and that's what we're talking about with this. So we're going negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2, and that's what we're looking at. So we're cutting sine like this. So that sine inverse will look like this. Okay? So you're reflecting it. So I'll draw it again. Because I just erased my stuff. Okay, so we're taking sine from, so we have something like this for sine. Right? This is sine theta between negative pi over 2 and positive pi over 2, and then I'm flipping it over the line y equals x. And that's how I'm figuring out what the inverse sine looks like, right? Okay, so that's what we're doing for everything. So sine is like this. Cosine, we're going from 0 to pi for cosine. Arctan, inverse cosecant, inverse secant. We're restricting the domain of our functions, okay? In order to figure out our inverse.
Would you draw the inverse again?
Yeah, let's see. No, it's okay. But I'm just trying to flip it over this line, right? Over the line y equals x. So I think
think that my line would be somewhere like here, right?
So I haven't, don't know if I've drawn it perfectly, right?
So I think it's like this, right? I'm just nearing it. Something like that.
It's definitely in the textbook. Maybe I should have included a picture in the notes. But it's the same idea with inverses, that you're flipping it over that line x equals y. Okay? Okay, so how the heck, why do we care about this, right? How do I use this? Okay, let's look at number 7. Okay, so number 7 says, evaluate the following, sine x equals 1. How do I know that? Well, I could look at the unit circle. Right, so here, what am I trying to figure out here? You're trying to find x, which is an angle, right? This is an angle. Number 8, theta, is an angle. Number 9, 3x, that's my angle, right? So I could go back to my unit circle, and I'm looking for an angle. What angle makes sine of x 1? Good, so I have pi over 2. If I go all the way around the unit circle again, add, it's 2 pi plus pi over 2, 4 pi plus pi over, right? So you get a multiple answers. But let's say we wanted to put this into our calculator. Let's say we wanted to write this nicely. So I take this and I do the inverse of it, sine inverse of sine of x equals sine inverse of 1, right? So last time when we talked about inverses, I said f of f inverse of x equals x, right? And that's why we're doing this, because then I get x equals sine inverse of 1, and I believe you can even enter this into your calculator, right? My calculator doesn't work right now. But if you do second above sine, there should be a sine inverse. Right? Is that true? Okay. And what did you get?
9.
So yours is in degrees. Switch yours to radians. Can I borrow your calculator?
So this is something that I had a student show me one time too, which makes complete sense mathematically. Right?
So here you get sine inverse of 1. Again, here above sine is the sine inverse button. Can you guys see it? So here we got 1.5707. What the heck is that, right? So you know all your angles have pi in the numerator, right? So let's divide all of these by pi, and we'll see what the angle is. So divided by pi, pi is above the little caret here, and I get 0.5. So that means I have pi over 2 is my answer. So whatever answer you get here, if you divide it by pi, it will give you the fractional part of your angle. Okay? So this would be pi over 2.
Did you figure out how to fit in the pi? So if you got 90, make sure your calculator is in radians. Because we know from the first page that 90 degrees is pi over 2, right?
But again, if I'm looking at my unit circle, if I have this memorized because I don't have my nice calculator on the test, I go and I say, okay, what angle makes sine 1? At what angle is my x, is my y value 1? And it's pi over 2. Okay? So number 8, cosine squared theta equals 1/2. Oh my goodness. So I'm trying to solve for theta, which is an angle. So what do I do? Well, I have something squared, right? Let's get rid of that squared. Can I square root both sides? That seems okay. So square root both sides, and I get cosine theta equals the square root of a fraction is the square root of the numerator divided by the square root of the denominator. So I have 1 over square root of 2. good, which Gabriel is rationalizing. We don't really like radicals in the denominator. So if we rationalize this, so we all know how to rationalize, yeah? You multiply by the root in the denominator to get rid of it. Okay. So now I'm going to take the inverse cosine of both sides. But now again, I'm saying what angle makes cosine square root of 2 over 2? So you're looking at the unit circle already, right? Good. So you're saying cosine is the x value, pi over 2 is pi over 4. Square root of 2 over 2 is pi over 4. Anything else? Cosine is the x value.
7 pi over 4.
7 pi over 4, good. So you can get two different values too, right?
Wait, so 1 is pi over 4 and 2?
We rationalize this. So if I ever have a radical in the denominator, I don't really like that. So you multiply by square root of 2 over square root of 2, because square root of 2 over square root of 2 is 2 in the denominator, and then you're left with square root of 2 in the numerator. Okay, so I'm going to, again, do cosine inverse of cosine theta equals cosine inverse of square root of 2 over 2. And I get theta equals cosine inverse of square root of 2 over 2. Again, that's a property of functional inverses. This is something you can put into your calculator, right? If you can't use your calculator, you can look at the unit circle, and we got theta equals, what was it again?
Pi
over 4. 7 pi over 4, good. And because of the repetitiveness of sine and cosine, right, the periodicity, it repeats itself every 2 pi, I could add 2 pi to each of these and get multiple answers, right? Okay, so number 9, so are you guys okay now? This is okay? Okay, number 9, what's different? What should we add to number 9?
The 3.
The 3 in front of the x, okay, good. So who can help me?
Do you just take the arcsine the right side and then divide it by 3?
Good, because in order to get rid of sine, I need to do arcsine. Good, and then I'll get 3x. Okay, so I'm going to do the inverse sine of both sides. And I get 3x equals sine inverse of square root of 2 over 2. Okay, what's sine inverse of square root of 2 over 2? So what angle makes sine square root of 2 over 2?
Pi
over 4. And then there's multiple different ones, right? So this would be 3x equals pi over 4. Seven pi over 4. So this one was cosine. We're doing sine now. 3 pi over 4. And then you could add 2 pi to each of those an infinite number of times, right? And get multiple answers. Good. So the point of this is we're trying to solve for x, right? We're trying to get x equals something. But here we have 3x. So we need to divide both sides by 3. And I'm going to divide all of my answers by 3. Sometimes here at this point, making it two separate answers sometimes is helpful for people to see a little easier. But then I would get x equals pi over 12. And x equals what? Okay, and then the last thing on this page is different trigonometric values. So This is not using the unit circle, right? So here's the degrees, here's the radians. So here, if I'm looking at this and I'm going, okay, what is tangent of 7 pi over 6? That's square root of 3 over 3, right? So I don't know if you guys want to make flashcards for everything, if you guys want to use the unit circle. I have no idea. Yeah? Somebody was telling me in my other class about something called Quizlet.
Yeah.
What? Do you guys know it?
Yeah.
Why are you guys laughing?
You sound so amazed. It's like a really common thing.
I never used it. I've been out of high school for a while, y'all. So. Okay, so I've been out of high school for at least that long. So I don't know it. I never used it. But the reason I know about it is because I do have some kids who will, you know, some people make flashcards and then they share them with the class. I've had people do that in previous classes. So if somebody's doing that, because on your phone you can just do, like, you can make a flashcard. I don't know, I haven't used it. You can, like, make a flashcard and tap and it'll flip it over and stuff. So I've had people do that before and then share it with the class. Listen, y'all, I'm old, okay? I don't know these things. But I like to start the dialogue in class so that people share their resources, right? If these are people you guys are going to be in class with for a while, make a buddy, make a study buddy, work on homework together. Don't sit there and do it by yourself, right? Even when I was in undergrad, I would go, there was a math learning center in the library where there was a table, there were like 2-3 math tutors, and I would go there and do my homework. That way I would just do my homework, and if I ever got stuck, I would just raise my hand and ask a question, and the tutor would answer it so that I could keep moving and not sit there and be like, oh my gosh, what am I supposed to do next? I don't know anything, right? So, I mean, you got to figure out ways to do that, right? Because this, maybe you're looking at it and going, I have no, and you're entering stuff into Pearson, and you're going, I have no idea, why am I getting this wrong, what's going on? And it could have just been a simple thing like divide by 3, right? So that's why I have the awkward introductions the first day of class. That's why I make you guys exchange phone numbers, because I think it's helpful. Okay? Okay, so did anybody print 2.1 homework? Okay, so we'll stop here today then. And then we'll print chapter 2, and we'll make sure that we can get started. So let me stop videotaping and then I can answer questions. If you guys want to do homework for a couple minutes.